Hi guys, Omar is here. Today we have something unexpected. Windows NT finally has NVMe support. And that's right. In 2025, a 1996 operating system just received an NVMe driver. Of course, it's a third-party support, but still, what's going on? The older these OSs get, the more compatible they seem to become. Earlier this year, we even saw Windows 3.1 getting a brand new VB driver that lets us enjoy Windows 3X interface in full HD on real hardware with modern GPUs. It's seen a lot of fine-tuning since then, and it works great. This new NVMe driver was crafted by TechOmancer and was primarily made for Windows 2000. Now, when it comes to Windows 2K, there are basically two ways to bring NVMe support. Plan A, write a completely new driver from scratch. And that's exactly what this driver is. We're talking about a real ScsiPort miniport driver built for the classic NT SCSI storage stack. Its job is to translate SCSI commands into NVMe commands and back again, essentially letting the legacy SCSI stack talk to modern NVMe hardware. And there is a plan B, modify the OS to work with existing drivers. Plan B requires some, reverse engineering, patching the kernel, importing newer system files, and making sure everything a modern driver expects actually exists in the older OS. But once you figure that out, the big advantage is that with minimal or no changes, you can run other drivers too. That's how Windows 2000 gained NVMe, USB 3X, and ACI support, by using drivers originally meant for newer systems like Windows 7 or 8. I'm not sure if TechOmancer knew there was already a working NVMe driver for Windows 2000. This could have derailed the whole project, and we wouldn't be talking about NVMe support in NT4 today. The existing NVMe driver is a backport. It relies on kernel modifications that are much harder to bring to NT4. More specifically, it uses the newer storage stack called StorePort, which first appeared in Windows Server 2003 and became standard starting with Windows Vista. This driver, on the other hand, is a native Windows NT SCSI miniport, a storage stack that behaves almost identically in both Windows NT and Windows 2K. There are some small differences, but if you know how to design a SCSI to NVMe driver for Windows 2000, you basically know how to make it work on NT4 as well. And that's exactly what happened. Now let's talk about the test system. I gave the Ryzen 9 9900X build, which you might have seen in some of my recent videos, a break today. Instead, I'm using a Coffee Lake 9th Gen i5, the 9500 model. And what's more interesting is the Asus B360 Plus motherboard, which is perfect for an OS like NT4. Mostly because it still includes two classic PCI slots, one of them is used with an ILS 4000 sound card. Now, how do we actually install Windows NT4 on modern hardware? Well, we don't have to worry about having a fast CPU, a modern motherboard, and tons of RAM. Windows NT is perfectly fine with fast hardware. The real problem most of the time is the disk controller. If NT can't initialize it, whether it's SATA or now NVMe, we get a 07B bluescreen and that's the end of it. The good news is that for SATA controllers we have the UniATA drivers, and they really do feel like magic. And when I say magic, I mean it. As long as UniATA loads, Windows NT can boot on almost anything with a SATA port. We can even install NT in a virtual machine, add the UniATA drivers there, move that installation to real hardware, and it will still boot. That's cool, but instead of going through a virtual machine, it's much faster to use the Universal NT Installer, which deploys a pre-configured Windows NT installation with all the drivers already included. The NVMe drivers will be added in the upcoming release and will be integrated not only in NT4 but also in NT 3.5 and 3.5.1. Yes, this means now we have an active NVMe support in an OS from 1994. This is possible because NT 3.5 and NT4 share a compatible ScsiPort architecture, and indeed the driver actually works. I tested a Samsung NVMe drive in NT 3.5.1. It was recognized, showed up in Disk Manager, and what can I say? So far, so good. But now let's focus on Windows NT 4, which has driver support for the first generation of PCIe GPUs. So we can use it with something like a Quadro FX 4500. This is an NVIDIA G70 based card released in the summer of 2005. And coincidentally, the last NVIDIA driver for Windows NT 4 was released around the same time. Even though this specific card isn't listed in the INF file, we can install it by selecting the generic NVIDIA PCIe Quadro entry from the list, and after a quick restart, we're running in full HD with no glitches at all. Which kind of makes sense, these Quadro cards were essentially very expensive counterparts of the regular GeForce series, just with different drivers. So in the end, we're basically using what it used to be, a very expensive driver. And speaking of drivers, let's see how we can install this NVMe driver in Windows NT 4. It's actually not complicated at all. In the control panel, we open the SCSI adapters icon and we simply point to the driver. After the next restart, the NVMe is ready to use. I first tested it with a Kingston A2000 NVMe drive, which I originally planned to use for Windows ME, but it didn't work out as expected. However, this time we do have a real driver and the NVMe controller initializes correctly and the drive becomes fully accessible. Now it works and it's fast, but how fast? To find out, I tried a few benchmarking tools like CSoft Sandra and Crystal Dismark. Well, to get accurate results, these bench programs want to talk directly to the drives, bypassing the system cache. To do this, they use a special Windows flag called File Flag No Buffering. Now, both of my benchmarks failed to write any data, and I have to assume this is why, that this direct I/O path just isn't working. In some benchmarking tools like DiskBench, we can disable the Direct I/O option. Forcing this setting lets the tool run, but it does so by falling back to the system cache. So while we can finally get some numbers, it's more like getting an idea of how fast the system cache is, but not the actual NVMe drive. Next, I tried another drive. The same Samsung PM981 I used with NT 3.5.1. Nothing fancy here, it's a 2017 Gen 3 drive, but guess what? Now Crystal Disk Mark works and we're getting read speeds of around 1400 megabytes per second. This drive can do better, but even so, these are crazy speeds for Windows NT 4, and it's great to see that the system remains perfectly stable. I also tested an Intel NVMe drive, and like the Kingston drive, this one couldn't be benchmarked, and the driver still wasn't able to read the correct model name from the firmware, which happened with all three drives. I'm sure at least one of these issues will be fixed in the next release of the driver. Alright, what's next now that we have NVMe support and a beefy GPU for NT4? How beefy? Well, we're getting over 600 FPS in Quake 3 at full HD, so that's something. But we can't do much gaming because official DirectX support is limited to DirectX 3. However, we do have very good OpenGL support, so we need to stick to games that use OpenGL and don't complain about DirectX. By the way, we can upgrade to an unofficial but stable DirectX 5 package. And lately, there have been attempts to bring newer DirectX versions to NT4, but that's still a work in progress. Now, if we stick with games that had native support, Serious Sam, the first encounter from 2001, had probably the most advanced graphics. So here we have an OS from 1996, rendering a game from 2001 through OpenGL 1.2, a technology introduced in 1998, and the game looks like this. Meanwhile, a 2025 title like The Outer Worlds 2 running on an RTX 1590 with literally hundreds to 1000 times more compute power, can still struggle when certain settings are turned on. So what's going on? Of course, anyone who understands the stack of technologies behind a modern game can appreciate every little detail, but it's hard to explain to someone less technical why a newer game needs so much raw compute power to produce graphics that, let's be honest, don't feel that out of this world compared to some older titles. Now to wrap things up, I also tested a PCIe gigabit card from Broadcom, a 2012 model with a 5722 chip, and it works perfectly with the last drivers released for Windows NT back in 2007. Of course, the browsing experience isn't great on today's web, but we can still have fun discovering sites that are optimized for old browsers, and the whole experience feels very similar to browsing the web in the late 90s. And since much modern software won't run on NT4, it's always a pleasure to find new programs that still work. One example is the TCP/IP Mod 6 player, which runs fine using GDI rendering, and the CPU usage stays around 30% when playing a Full HD MP4 file made for YouTube. So, in the end, a big thanks to Dominic Baer, aka TechOmancer, for putting together this driver. It's always a pleasure to revisit Windows NT. Next time we'll pay a visit to Windows Longhorn. It was originally planned for this week, but when I saw there is a new NVMe driver for NT4, I couldn't help myself. Thanks for watching. Amores out.